Hello, everybody.
Perfect. Thank you. Last time had part one on Nelly Furtado, and this week is obviously part two. So we will be covering Loose and the Spirit Indestructible. And Rochard, what are your memories of this era, the second half of Nelly Furtado?
I remember. Okay, this is going to start off bad, but it may have an ending by the end of this podcast. All right, so I remember, like, getting off of Folklore. I was like, yeah, Folklore, blah, 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 blah. And then kind of, like, Nelly kind of, like, went off and did whatever she needed to do in her personal life until she came back onto the album. So, I don't know which one was the first. I'm thinking it was Maneater. Or was I don't think it was Promiscuous
Girls. No, I think it was Maneater dropped first, I think, yeah.
Yeah, so one day I'm sitting there, and I'm hearing exactly MTV talking about Nelly Furtado's new album. I'm like, yeah, Nelly Furtado's coming out with a new album. I'm so excited, blah, blah, blah. Then I hear Maneater, and I'm like, okay. So, because, like, usually, like, listening to her last two albums, I'm expecting them to be more eclectic. So, like, it threw me off a little bit because it kind of had, like, that throwback 80s Kim Carnes, Betty Davis Eyes kind of shit to it. And I was like, okay, what's this? And then I remember going to this girl's party I was trying to get at. And I
remember, it's always a girl with you, man.
It's always. It's just 95% of my stories involve yep. women. So, yeah, that's how it works. So, I go to this party where this girl's at. I already heard Promiscuous Girl, and I was already dismissed the hell out of it. And I was like, this song is not going nowhere. So we're sitting there, right? It's me, my brother. And it's like, most of the party was like white people. So I'm sitting there. And it's at night, and everybody's doing what they gotta do. And then all of a sudden, the song comes on the radio. And all of a sudden, like, all the white girls started singing the song. And my brother looked at me, and he's like, I'm letting you know the song's gonna be a hit. Just letting you know. And when the album first came out for me, I was just like, because I'm so used to the eclectic, like, kind of like world sounds of Nelly Furtado. So it was to be streamlined, like in full-on Timbaland, I was kind of like, what the fuck is going on? But as we go on, we'll get into what goes on later. But that was my initial result to it. I bought the CD because I was a loyal Nelly Furtado fan, and I played it, and I just dismissed the shit out of it. I was like, this is not the Nelly I'm listening to. Although I will say that I love Say It Right, which is great. At that point in time, when that song came out, I loved that song. But I kind of, like, dismissed. Oh, and Showtime. But then the rest of the album I pretty much dismissed until, like, later on down the road. So that's my opening feeling of that album when it first came out.
Okay, I'm pretty much the polar opposite to all of that. Yeah, I love this album from pretty much day one. Promiscuous Girl I got immediately. And I think, actually, Promiscuous Girl might have dropped a couple of weeks before Maneater. Maneater, the first time I heard it, I was like, what the fuck is this? I didn't really like it. But then, you know, it's a real earworm. So within kind of, you know, 2-3 spins of it, I was like, yeah, okay, I can see. And then it hit number one first week in the UK. And I was like, oh my God. So you know what you're saying about white girls and stuff? I was like, yeah. And around that time I did, I think it was someone's birthday party or engagement party I was DJing at. I think I was DJing at an engagement party, and the last song, they're all like, oh, play one more song. I was like, all right, fine, you choose. And then this girl came up to me and said, oh, please play Nelly Furtado, Maneater. And everyone just went nuts. And I was like, wow, there's something going on here. And yeah, it really worked. It absolutely worked. It was a good song. I think, we'll get more into the specifics of Loose. But as I kind of alluded to last week, this was the album of me and my wife getting together. So when we were initially in negotiations to become boyfriend and girlfriend. It sounds so funny to say that all these years later, but yeah, it was 2006. It was literally when Promiscuous Girl and Loose Maneater and Promiscuous Girl were dropping. Loose was the album that year. We even went to see Nelly Furtado Loose concert in almost exactly 10 years ago now. And so for me and my wife, this album is the epitome of the one kind of work of music that ties us together from that era. So I always have like an irrational amount of love for this. But I still think it's a really great album. I still listen to it periodically and love it. I think it's brilliant. I can totally see why there's so much criticism about it. But in the end, I'm kind of like, you know, fuck the criticism. I think you can justify everything on this album pretty much. So should we get into it?
Okay, sure.
Okay.
I didn't say it like that. I was going along with the flow. With the flow. Where'd that dead air come from? I thought you were going to go right into it, but go ahead.
God, I'm sorry. Do you know what? Like, yeah, I had a nap earlier this afternoon. Like, it was probably the first nap I've had, and I'm really boosted right now. So, just I might go off on tangents. All right. So, let's get more professional podcasting. Yay! Right. So, Nelly Furtado, Loose. It was released in 2006, around summertime in 2006. So, as you kind of said before, the two singles in particular that preceded it were Maneater and Promiscuous, And those songs, for me, are an incredible 1-2 punch if you're a DJ. My God, those two cover so many bases if you're a DJ. You've got the kind of R&B stroke danceness of Promiscuous, and you've got the pure kind of white, I say this in a loving way, but you know what I mean, like kind of like white girl nightclub dance. I think the BPM is 133 on it, and those two between them just covered everything in just the first two songs. It was incredible, absolutely incredible. I mean, I'm not really the biggest fan of Nelly's videos. I don't think many of them have really hit the spot. There's always something a little bit off, but in terms of, because even these two videos, I barely remember them too much. I vaguely remember Promiscuous, but it wasn't exactly a classic. I think Say It Right was a good video.
It was like a typical 90s video.
Basically, it's kind of like this joke. I know there's going to be some Canadians listening, and I'm probably going to piss you off. But in How I Met Your Mother, I remember Robin was like, Robin Scherbatsky was like, "Oh, we didn't get the 80s until 1993 in Canada," and I was actually in Canada in 1993, and that's the most accurate statement I've ever heard. So sometimes Canada's just a bit after things. Obviously, she was in America, but yeah, it was kind of a little bit out of touch. Even actually, I was going to mention it on last week's one. Like, you know, we were talking about Try, why that didn't blow up. Like, the video of Try is really kind of, it's a bit too esoteric and a bit, I don't know. It just needed to be a simple video, and it's just too much kind of, you had to buy into it too much. Like, it was kind of old schooly character development, blah, blah, blah. It didn't quite hit. Sometimes you just need to Occam's razor that shit. And I guess this Promiscuous is more of an Occam's razor video, I guess.
Oh my God.
Yeah. Hang on, wait. So, let's get into Nelly's image on Loose, her sexed up, vampy image. I'm guessing you weren't a fan.
No, I was not. I mean, I get it. Like, let me preface this. I'm not one of them prude guys. I'm just not. I just, like, it just took me, like, from where Folklore was going, I thought she was going to, okay. The reason why I had such an aversion to this album, because I felt like from Mon Nelly to Folklore, I thought she was getting more sophisticated with her sounds. And then when this album came out, I felt like everything, it just felt like to me, and like I said, if her prerogative to do whatever she wanted to do, so who am I to judge? But I just said, it felt like for me, I was like, this whole album felt like when it came out, it was like, okay, your last album didn't sell well. So now you really gotta market yourself to put this thing out there. And it just felt like to me, like that's what it was. And like I don't blame her because she's a musician. She has to. She's also a businesswoman, so she has to sell CDs. It's not always about that, especially if you've achieved a certain amount of success with your first album, and then your next album doesn't make as much. So you really got to go for what you know. So when you pull Timbaland in them, and you kind of capitalize on when she did get your freak on and Miss Jade, Ching Ching, it's basically okay. So which way can you go? Are you going to go off the deep end into more of like that quote unquote serious artist thing? Or are you going to kind of like lean yourself more towards like that accessible, like pop music? And she kind of leaned towards that other way. Even though it's like when the album first starts off with the Afraid song, I think that feels like the most Nelly-ish, kind of like inspiring kind of song when it comes out there. And it goes right into Man Eater Promiscuous. It's kind of like that, like she still has like that hopeful, kind of like, there's more to life than just the surface level stuff in that first song. And maybe a couple of other songs on here. But then it goes right into Man Eater and Promiscuous. So it's kind of like that, the two Nellies kind of together. Where it's like, because I remember later on she was talking about the Promiscuous Girl song. She wasn't a fan of it promoting promiscuousness. But she kind of like changed the lyrics on one of the lines or something like that. They kind of like water it down a little bit. I remember she said that later on. So I just remember when I heard this album, like I know why it's a hit and I know why it's her biggest album. I get that part. But I always had in the back of my head where it was kind of like, I felt like Timbaland was in the zone and the rest of the producers and songwriters on this. But I also felt like she kind of had to do it in a sense to kind of like redeem herself from the failure of Folklore's lack of record sales. It just feel like that for me. It's not a bad album by any stretch of the memory. I just like, for me as a Nelly Furtado fan that loved Folklore, I wanted something more along the lines of that, but pushed forward. And then when I heard this one, it was kind of like, it was streamlined and ultra accessible, and there were hits for days on it. So,
yeah, I mean, for me, I have a very different point of view. If listeners haven't listened to our Madonna podcast, then we kind of entered this parallel universe where basically, which Madonna album was it? Hard Candy? Where she basically, we said, you know what, if she had actually teamed up with Timbaland in 2006 when Timbaland was hot, then Madonna could have made an amazing album. And then you were like, kind of like, I think you said, yeah, kind of like Nelly Furtado's album Loose. And then I just, that blew my mind. I was like, oh my God, that's the most accurate saying ever. Yeah, why didn't she? And then it's really funny. So I was reading just like a retrospective of this and of Loose. And Nelly actually said she didn't like directly model it on Ray of Light, but she was inspired by Ray of Light predominantly for this album, which is a really bizarre thing because this doesn't really sound like Ray of Light at all. But I think she was getting her Madonna on, basically. And she said that she liked trying on different hats and stuff like that. And I mean, okay, you can look at her first two albums and say, yeah, the progression from that to this makes no sense at all. Absolutely, I completely agree. But then again, it's her prerogative to do what she wants. And obviously, you know, you could look at it and say, okay, the record company pressured her into this and blah, 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 blah. But already Timbaland had put out feelers for her. And she'd already linked up on What About My Jing 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 and the Get Your Freak On remix, as you said. So there was the history between her and Timbaland. And I think they were a good natural fit anyway. The other thing is you've got to mention Timbaland. Sorry, what were you going to say? I'll come back to it.
No, I was going to say, before we go back to this, because you know what also colored my opinion afterwards, after this? Because I remember when MIA went to go visit Timbaland before she did Kala. And then I remember her saying specifically, like, she didn't want to get Nelly Furtado-ized by Timbaland. I remember her saying specifically that, and that's why she kind of broke off with Timbaland. And that was a crazy thing for her. So I can see, I later on I'll probably send it to you or later on or something like that, but I just remember her saying she didn't want to get Nelly Furtado-ized on her next album. Wow. After she did Arular.
I didn't know that. I'd never heard her say that. I know she kind of alluded to it, but that's why come round is like a bonus track tacked on at the end of Carla. But okay, so yeah, so let's come back to Timbaland. So this is Timbaland's hottest streak ever. This is his, I'm not going to say, oh, it's his kind of, you know, Jordan moment or anything like that, because that, if you're talking about quality, then he's had various peaks and you just have to, it depends what you want, basically. You know, you got someone who goes back at this point 25 years, yeah. So around the Loose era, his work with Justin Timberlake and a couple of other artists, he doubled up with Danger, and Danger's a massive part of all of the success. So the triumvirate was really Nelly Furtado, Justin Timberlake, and Timbaland. And they took over 2006. In case you're younger and just don't remember or just didn't realize, my God, they were everywhere, those three. And it kind of, it rolled over into 2007, because I think that's when Timbaland released Shock Value, and they had Give It To Me and a couple of other songs and stuff. But really, it's Loose and Future Sex Love Sounds. Those two are the epitome of Timbaland hitting his hottest commercial streak, definitely, without a doubt. So it's really funny because now there's a lot of, you know, I try and put myself in your average person's point of view. They would look at it and think, okay, this was the last time Nelly Furtado did anything of any worth, yeah, commercially. Because since then, Mi Plan was a Spanish language album. It didn't really hit. Spirit Indestructible, we'll get to that. And she's finally coming back this year. And that's it. So you're looking at 2006, 7 for when you're getting the last kind of radio hits from her. So they might associate her with Timbaland and think, okay, Timbaland made her hot. And then since then, she's just fallen off a cliff effectively. And then they'd look into it and think, okay, maybe that's not quite true. But on this album, I think it flows brilliantly. Okay, you've got the intro track Afraid, and then you've got the more commercial aspects of Maneater, Promiscuous, Glow, definitely, and then it kind of, almost kind of Aaliyah-ish Showtime a little bit. Well, actually, that's something I could imagine Madonna having done, definitely Showtime. Then you've got a couple of Spanish language tracks, and which I like both of them, actually. Particularly, I did not like No Hay Igual at the time, and then it just grew and grew and grew on me. And then you get into the section where it's kind of like, Say It Right, and then I think Do It's kind of slapped in a bit just to keep the momentum going. But
yeah, I hate that song.
I actually like Do It, but I don't like the positioning of it. Yeah, it's got that Madonna vibe for me. I just enjoyed it, you know. It's very cheesy and very meaningless, but fun. Say It Right, In God's Hands, Wait For You, which is one of my favourite songs of it, and All Good Things Come To An End. And then you have various... I'll actually come to the bonus UK tracks because one of them is one of the best songs on the whole album, basically. It's a little bit hit and miss depending on certain things, but everything is justified to me pretty much. I think my wife's favorite song of the whole album is In God's Hands, which I could not stand that song at the time, and then it kind of just through her playing it kind of wore me down. But yeah, I tell you what, before we get into anything else, what are your favorite three tracks from this album, if you have three?
Okay, so I would say Afraid, I would say It Right, and I would say Wait For You. I would give those three. And then the rest of it is kind of like, okay, Showtime would probably be like the fourth, if you force me to do four. And then the rest of it is like, it's not bad, but that's not what I want to hear from Nelly Furtado. So, like, on a critical side, like, I get why the album's a hit and it's not a bad album. But on the Nelly Furtado fan side, it's kind of like, I didn't get what I wanted out of this album. I'll say this. Like you said, like, going back to what you said, like, she has the right to do what she wants. Like, it's not every album's going to be for me. Like, there's many albums from certain artists that are, like, I'm a diehard fan of that they're not for me. But they try a different thing. And I was like, you earn the right to kind of do that. Be it beyond you. Because the one thing I do hate is even if you're fans, this is something that I plan on doing if my book's ever a hit. Like, I'm not going to, like, I would never disrespect my fans by doing something that I didn't want to do. And waste their time with something like, okay, now be cynical enough to go, okay, this is my fans' likes. So let me repeat that 15,000 times. You know what I'm saying? Even though I may not have liked what I've heard on this album, it's like, and I have a certain opinion about it. Like, I would never fault Nelly Furtado for not doing what she wants. She worked her ass off to get to that point. So who am I to sit there and look down on her or something like that? So when I criticize this album, I'm not criticizing it because I think it's terrible or I think she could have done better. The flow just didn't go for me at that time. Now, later on in life, I kind of had a little bit more appreciation for it. Like I respect what she did because even she could have phoned it. She could have did the old thing back in the day that used to do on albums, three hits and all filler. She didn't do that either. You know what I'm trying to say? So I can't get mad at that either. You know what I'm trying to say? Like, she didn't do lazy beats or lazy lyrics or something like that. Like, there was still some professionalism involved in it. It just didn't jive with me at that point.
Yeah, and I can appreciate that. The thing that I'd say is that Nelly is a very eclectic artist and she has a wide variety of tastes. And it doesn't surprise me that she ended up making an album like this. Maybe that it ended up exactly like this, but one that ended up in this kind of vein. She'd already worked with Timbaland a little bit and she, I mean, come on, look, she's basically the same age as us. Like, I think we said, like, she's like a year older than me, a year younger than you. And who of our ages wasn't a Madonna fan, or at least heavily influenced by Madonna?
Oh, yeah.
And you can imagine her as a young girl of being massively influenced by Madonna. This is her getting her Madonna on in a lot of ways. Now, I think maybe she might have thought when she started recording all this that she was getting a different Timbaland. She might have thought, okay, I'm getting the Timbaland who worked with Aaliyah, or I'm getting the Timbaland from this, that, whatever, whatever. Or the Missy one, you know. This is wildly different. This is Timbaland being like, you know what, fuck it, I just want everyone. You know, once he teamed up with Danger, everything changed, and they just tapped into this absolute, it was kind of like almost an 80s throwback, a lot of it was, with some, you know, plenty of synths and those kind of beats and stuff. And for the most part, I think it worked really well. A lot of also Arabic samples, Indian samples, and that comes back to bite them at certain times through lawsuits and stuff like that. I reckon she probably got a bit of a shock from the backlash about certain other things, like lawsuits coming due to unlicensed samples and stuff, because, you know, she really doesn't come across as that kind of person. She kind of comes across as the sort of person that doesn't want anything to do with that kind of stuff. So,
oh yeah,
you know, I don't think she was coerced into everything on this album at all. I think she just inhabited it. Now, that I don't think it's necessarily a natural fit for what you'd say the rest of her career ended up being like before and after this. I understand that, but I don't think it dampens the validity of Loose for me at all. It's kind of like, look, do you know what, like, I say this with all the love in the world, but in our mid-20s, you know, we thought we were the shit, right? And then you look back and think, God, I was a bit of a dick. You know, I was actually a little bit of a dick. And kind of like, I still own it. I'm still glad of the decisions that I made in general. There's a couple of big errors, but otherwise I'm like, yeah, fine. I was a bit of a dick, but at least I kind of enjoyed my life and stuff. And that's that kind of album. Loose is that kind of album that she's,
oh yeah,
you know, she's not always making coherent decisions, but it's really fun and she commits to it and it got her to another place in life. Forget about commercially or within the record industry, but just generally, you know? Okay, let me do my favorite. I'll struggle to get it to three, but I'd probably say Promiscuous, Showtime, Say It Right. I'm going to cheat. Do you know what? I need five. I need at least five. Promiscuous, Showtime, Say It Right, Wait For You, and all good things come to an end. I'm gonna put on the bonus track, Somebody to Love. Did you get that bonus track there?
No, I got Tabusk Spanish version. That's all we got.
That's all you got.
Yeah, I mean, unless there was a version that I didn't pick. You know why? Because usually back in the day, I would search for like the special edition. But because I didn't like the singles, I was like kind of like on the edge anyway. So maybe there was a another version of it. Let me see.
I think you guys got something called Undercover, and that was it. Maybe, I don't know.
The Target Edition got Runaway, Photo Gallery.
Christ, I don't know what those songs are.
Undercover, we got Undercover. There's Undercover for iTunes. There was Runaway. For Target got like a couple of like Man Eater videos and in a studio with Target and a photo gallery. What the hell?
I've never heard of hang on, sorry. I might be really dumb. I'm sure it's an actual photo gallery, not a song called Photo Gallery.
Yeah, it's an actual photo gallery. I think it might be.
Yeah, Runaway, I've never heard of Runaway.
Like, what the hell?
I've never heard of Runaway before. So we got two, yeah. Let My Hair Down and Somebody to Love. So Let My Hair Down was, as we kind of alluded to last week, Track and Field, they have nothing to do with this album whatsoever except for one bonus track, which is Let My Hair Down, which I really couldn't stand at first. Then it kind of grew on me because I played the album so much, but I still don't think it's the best track. It's kind of really cheesy. Somebody to Love, on the other hand, is one of the best things she's ever done in her entire life. It's that really good a song. Yeah, it's absolutely incredible. And it's the perfect way to end the album, actually, as a bonus. Perfect. I was always kind of like, this should have been on the real album, but I can see why it wasn't. But it's such a good song. Which is another reason I love the album so much. I mean, Somebody to Love is, oh, man. I'd love it if there are any fans out there who have the same amount of affection for that song as me. So, okay. Should we just pick a few kind of isolated moments from this, from Loose? I'm going to pick... Okay, what did you think of her rapping on Promiscuous?
I tolerated it as much as I could, but it was passable.
It's kind of like... It's kind of like...
I feel bad because I know this is your album and I feel like I'm being addicted.
No. Listen, but do you know what? We've done the opposite so many times when you just have this album. I'm just like sitting there like... Put it this way. Obviously, Promiscuous is not like Illmatic levels of rapping or anything. But for a club song, for kind of the younger audience, it was good fun, basically. And it's Timbaland rapping. I mean, Magoo used to write his raps and it's like, oh, Jesus kind of thing, you know. I don't know.
Well, let me ask you a question. Whose rap is better, hers on this one or Madonna on American Life?
That's really low. That's a low blow, man. This is way better. At least this serves a proper function. Oh, I love Promiscuous Girl. I can't tell you, it was a DJ's dream, this song, except the intro. The intro was incredibly annoying. But then you used to have a version where a bit of the beat got looped, like for about 8 bars or something. I always thought that was the kind of cheat version. But basically, you'd kind of stop it, stop the whole party, and then, have I turned you on? No, I don't think so. And then everyone would just like, be like, wow, rah, like that. Yeah, so that was the kind of fun. Showtime, yeah, that track was just wicked. It was just dope. Such a chilled vibe. I don't think Timbaland had anything to do with it. I think it was Danger's beat. And that was kind of like the most Aaliyah-ish moment to an extent. I mean, I don't think Aaliyah would have actually done that track, but it was a very nice, a lovely lilt to it and really kind of calmed everything down after that opening kind of four tracks. The couple of Spanish tracks, like I said before, No Igual, I did not like it at first, and then it just absolutely grew on me. Like, it's funny, when we were kind of preparing for this podcast, I was listening to this, and the one track that I just could not get out of my head was No Igual. Just could not get it out. So it was kind of, and when we talk about Mi Plan, I was like, I remember last week I was saying on Mi Plan, I was like, why didn't she just make more tracks like this? You know, or even the next one, Te Busqué. Then I was kind of like, what's wrong with these tracks? Just make more of these. What was the big deal? You know, I didn't get it. Absolutely bizarre. Say It Right, I think it's one of the best songs she ever recorded.
Yeah, I agree with that.
And if you talk about 80s vibes, that, my God, that could be in a Top Gun video. Just take, you wouldn't even have to do anything. Just put that in. Bang. Amazing. Tom Cruise, Motorcycle. There you go. Wait For You, I love that song. And All Good Things Come Through, and Chris Martin from Coldplay helped write that one, and I love that. I think that went to number one in this country, actually, from memory. I don't know, there's just so many singles as well on this, plus there's a couple of good album tracks like Showtime and Wait For You. There's so many singles. I don't get the hate for it sometimes. I just don't. I like, obviously, I think if you're tiring her with the brush from her first two albums, not tiring, but you know, if that's who you expect to come and you've sort of fed another line, then fine. I can understand why you get annoyed, but
yeah.
I just don't know.
No, it's not.
People got angry, like out of proportion about this album. And like, maybe it's the age I'm at, or as a DJ, or this, or because it's me and my wife's album. But it just seems there's a disproportionate amount of anger about this. And then it still went on to sell like 10 million almost around the world, you know?
Because you know why? I can tell you why. Because even she said that her, like, most of her diehard fans like Folklore more than this album. Because here's the thing. Here's my theory about it. It feels like the fans that were through the thick and thin with Will Nelly and Folklore were a fan of a certain kind of sound, of a certain kind of like her heritage, and that kind of like, you don't know what kind of sound you're gonna get in the next track and this and that. And then when this album came out, it was very uniform and Timbaland. So it's almost like you're not, if you were a fan who like, and like I said, some fans loved this one and love the other two, so it's not all fans, but there was a certain group of fans where they wanted to hear more of like a Folklore, more like a Will Nelly sound, and like this was not that sound.
Wait, I call bullshit on that. You see, you're saying this is a Timbaland, unified Timbaland album. No, it's not.
No, wait a minute, let me qualify. Okay, not just Timbaland, but that kind of that that kind of like streamlined feel. It doesn't sound like a Folklore or a Will Nelly. Like you, like he's like, he's like, it's not saying like every song is like Timbaland. It's just saying that it's very specifically going for that very popular feel. Like all those songs. Like the reason why I believe this album is more successful than the other two is because this is because it's just it's so accessible to everybody, not just to people who are Nelly Furtado fans. You trying to say?
Yeah.
Like if you listen to. Like, cause like some people listen to Will Nelly, they would not give Will. I know friends who didn't give Will Nelly the time of day that gave Luz the time of day. I know people who didn't give Folklore the time of day that gave Luz the time of day. Matter of fact, most of the people I knew in my circles weren't even Nelly Furtado fans. They liked like one song or two, but when this album came out, that's when the Nelly Furtado bandwagon got on. Like you gotta remember that.
Oh
that
yeah, time. I mean, listen, when I went to the concert, so that was what February 2007, then. It is funny because when she was doing songs from Whoa Nelly and Folklore, people generally didn't know what she was doing. Yeah, most of the crowd were there for Luce, basically. And, like, I remember, I haven't got the exact track listing, but I remember when she was doing a couple of things off Whoa Nelly, like Hey Man, no one knew what it was. Like, no one, basically. Maybe 10% of the crowd or something.
I was like, yeah, that's what I'm saying. Yeah. Wait,
this was like, hang on. This is the album that had I'm Like a Bird. Obviously, everyone knew I'm Like a Bird, yeah. And then from Folklore, they knew Forza because that was the football song, and she was kicking around these ridiculous footballs everywhere. And maybe they knew Powerless. Maybe. That was it. And so if you're talking pre-Luce, that's literally all anyone knew. And she did a couple of other songs from the other ones, but no one knew them. I was the only one fucking singing along. It's ridiculous.
And even worse, in America, the only song that she was known for up to that point when Luce came out was I'm Like a Bird. They didn't even really know the other ones. No singles in Folklore were even known in this country. Like the Powerless video came out, the Tribe video came out a few times, and that was it. I don't think the Forza video even came on MTV.
No, I don't think it would. I mean, it's a football song. Why would it come out in America?
And then, like I said, it's like in America, she's most likely known for I'm Like a Bird. And maybe Shouldn't the Radio. But even that is like a big maybe right there.
So basically, Luce is the outlier of her career, isn't it?
Mm-hmm.
But it's also the most popular album from her career by a long, long, long way.
Yes.
Which is weird, isn't it? Because it's the one that sounds least like her. It must be a bit of a head fuck for her, to be honest, because she's so talented. She's got so many strings to her bow. And then for her to be kind of, I don't know. I don't know if she is entirely encapsulated by Luce to your average person, but it sure feels like that. Maybe with a couple of exceptions, like I'm Like a Bird.
Yeah.
I mean, Me Plan, nothing hit from that, like in the wider context. And
I didn't even know it came out until I was farting around on iTunes. I was like, what? Me Plan? What the hell?
I was excited for it. And then I voiced my disapproval of it last week. Yeah. But
I think whoever the American person decided to bury that idea.
But like, you know, Salaam Remy was producing on that. Yeah, it had some good producers.
I know, but he's not like a known guy here. Maybe in the club scene, but maybe like in America, I could throw out his name and people won't even know who the fuck he is.
It's crazy.
I know who he is, but I guarantee you talk to the average American, they will have no clue who that guy is. Unless you were in the know. Other than that, they don't know who that dude is.
Crazy. Just crazy. He's one of my favorite producers ever.
I know who he... Yeah, I know, but I'm just saying...
He did half of Back to Black by Amy Winehouse. People... Do you know what? In fairness... Well, I mean, he also worked on Frank with her. In fairness, in the UK, I think if you... Maybe not your average person, but a general kind of person who likes music, if you mentioned Salaam Remy to them, they might not know the name, but if you said, okay, do you know this song, it was produced by Salaam Remy, they'd know the song. I think so. That guy, amazing.
I'm gonna say this. I think the other thing that happened is that she didn't come out with an album for a long time.
I think that's what
cemented this one as being the one that was going to be the one. Now if she did something where like right after this, like a year and a half, she came out another album, then maybe it can lessen the blow before this long, like, detour until Spirit Indestructible. But it just felt like this album came out, and then she took like a long ass break. Because Me Playing was not even on a blip in America. So the only thing that they knew was of Nelly Furtado in 2006 until Spirit Indestructible came out in 2012. So that's 6 years without it, some kind of American blip on the radar.
Yeah, yeah. And it's worth mentioning those 6 years had a lot of female performers do a lot of things. You know, Amy Winehouse herself dropped Back to Black. Adele came out. Rihanna dropped properly. God, there's so many, actually. Lady Gaga, Beyonce continued her world domination. So you're talking about a lot. I'm not just to reduce her to a female artist, but if you're talking about the loose sound, that was taken and run with by a lot of other artists. Or even just doing something completely different like Amy did or whatever, you know? So, yeah, it was a long time. 6 years is a long time to go without, you know? I think sometimes, like, you have label situations and you have this and that. And she always said all along, like with Luce, that she'd kind of envisaged it in advance. So maybe she was affected by folklore herself. I mean, you know, I'm sure she loves it, but thought, okay, this really, really didn't hit the mark. And then her label are pushing her to work with Timbaland, maybe, and like Timbaland's already put out feelers. So she was like, oh, I envisaged the artwork for this, like, you know, 3 years in advance. And then she already said she was going to, no matter what happened with the album, she was going to take some time off afterwards and stuff. So she went, you know, she did a tour. Her tour wasn't like, you know, a gigantic tour, but it was big enough. And then she took some time off and stuff. You know, she had a young kid as well. So obviously, you know, there are more important things.
It's time to get your kid, yeah.
Yeah. But if you're talking about, yeah, exactly what you're saying, if you're looking at a discography, you'd be like, okay, there's a gigantic blip. We'll get to Spirit Indestructible in a short while. And for most people, again, if you're talking blips on radars, that barely would have... Hang on, let me not go too far. Okay, I tell you what, let's start to wrap up Luce properly.
Okay.
Are you going to dare to give it a score, or should we just avoid that landmark?
All right, I'll do this. I'll give it 2 scores. If I'm doing like exactly my personal feelings from it, then I give it like a 7. But if you put my personal feelings in it, then I give it a 6. I'll do it that way. But that a 7, I'll say this: a 7 from me being critical is good, because there's not a lot of albums that even hit a 7. And that's just a testimony of how much I love Nelly Furtado. That album I don't like, I'm still giving a 7 if I detach my personal feelings and what I wanted from it, rather than looking at the album for what it was and what it was trying to achieve. It achieved what it achieved what it wanted to achieve and achieved the success. It just wasn't something I was looking for.
You know what? I'm not that far off the mark, to be honest, from what you've just said. So, I mean, obviously, if you take my personal mark for it, would be like a 10, because it's, you know, me and my wife's album.
Yeah.
If I put my critical hat on, then... Yeah, I'd probably go maybe 7.5, maybe an 8. But I mean, you could definitely pick holes in this album. You could say certain songs are too slight, like you said. Do it. You know, you hate that song. I can understand why, because it's a very repetitive and simple.
You should see my face when I first heard that song. I was like, the fuck is this? Like, are you kidding me? I wanted to throw the CD out the window. I was like, what are you doing? I like that. But then after I calmed down, I was like, okay, I see what you got. I see what you're doing. But I still wanted to throw the CD out the window, but I was like, I already spent the $15, so I'm good on it.
Yeah. I don't know. I mean, yeah, so critically, I'd probably go for about 7.5, maybe somewhere around that mark. But I just love the album. I love it. And it will always bring back... It's a time capsule for me, for sure.
Yeah. That's what art's supposed to be. I mean, yeah. Regardless of all this hit and critical shit, it's always about... How it affected you. Yeah. There's many things that I love that people think are trash. It's like, fuck that. I was like, if it resonates with you, that's all that matters. That's what art is supposed to be. Sometimes I think in this day and age, we lose it sometimes. That's the point of all this shit. It's not just about the money shit. It's not just about, like, does everybody like it or how many critics like it. It's like, did it resonate with you? Then that's all that matters. Because if that wasn't the case, then most of the artists that we appreciate right now wouldn't put out the music they put out, because a lot of the stuff I'm sure they listened to wasn't the most popular shit or the thing like that. It would be a very monochromatic world if everybody just liked the things everybody liked and they would just repeat the same shit over and over again.
Amen to that. Okay, I tell you what, let's wrap up Loose and then let's fast forward. Okay, we're going to skip over Me Plan because we've mentioned it twice now in the last couple of podcasts, and that's all I'm going to say on it. So you reached 2012 and there's an album by this lady called Nelly Furtado and it's called Spirit Indestructible. The funny thing is, we're probably one of the two of the only people on the planet who actually listens to this album a lot because it did not hit the mark. And like, the most amazing thing is that, so okay, here's my thing. I loved it at the time. I did love this album. I listened to it a lot. And then it kind of died down for me. Yeah, fine. And then re-listening to it for this podcast, so out of all the four, well, let's say five, let's be generous and include Me Plan, that out of all the five albums that I've been listening to, probably for the last month, yeah, because I've really enjoyed listening to it, this is the one that I keep coming back to again and again and again. And my God, this is such a good album. It's not perfect, but I'm going to say it right now. There's basically one song that I don't like out of 12. You'd be literally talking 11 songs I can just play all day, every day. And there's one song, and even that song's a perfectly all right song. I just don't like it. So I cannot stop listening to it. I cannot. Now, there are problems with it, and I can tell why it didn't hit the mark. Absolutely, we'll get into that. But what are your feelings on Spirit Industry?
Okay, so it was weird because like, after Loose, I was like, okay, whatever. So another Fidel's coming to the album. I was like, okay. And then I heard Big Hoops, and I think I heard Big Hoops, and I think I heard Spirit Indestructible. And I already liked those songs a little bit more than the Loose singles. I like the Big Hoops one because she started throwing all those old school sayings, old school like, what's the scenario, like high five, like high five. And then Spirit Indestructible went back to that more like spiritual uplifting Nelly Furtado, which is my favorite version of her. Whether she's being introspective about love or she's just being overly, like, just being, like, that optimistic without being corny kind of thing. So, those ones. But the one that got Parking Lot was, like, M.I.A. Junior. And then, and then the one that sold me on it was Bucket List. That's the one I was like, okay, yep. this is the one I'm talking about. Like I said, I feel like if this album came out like a year after Loose, then it would have been a hit. I feel like if it came out like a year after Loose or a year and a half after Loose, while The Iron was still hot, I think it would have been a hit. I think the problem with this one, there was a whole generation of kids. You gotta remember, like, Loose was the only album that most people knew. And I feel like a whole generation of teenagers went by and didn't know who the hell Nelly Furtado was, because she didn't build up a fan base over many albums. She only built up like this mainstream fan base because of one album, and then she had her diehard fans, which were even a smaller group. And I feel like Loose was that moment in time album. And then I feel like this one, if she came out like a year and a half afterwards, this one would have been like, okay, now she's still doing that mainstreamish kind of thing, but she's also putting more of herself back into it. And I think if there was another album that came out after that, like a year or two after this one, then she would have been back on the plot that she was on with Folklore. I felt like that for me.
Yeah, I can get that. Yeah. I mean, I think you're right. The Loose was the zeitgeist album in terms of commercially, for sure. Whereas I think Spirit Indestructible, what I love about it and what it's really grown, it's aged very well, let's just put it that way. A lot better than I thought it would at the time. I kind of thought, I was a bit worried the first couple of times I spun it. I was kind of like, this is going to come and go without a trace. And I was okay with that, fine. But then I thought, I just don't think this is going to age very well. And I'm really wrong. Like, I mean, I think it's aged incredibly well. And it's a genre hopper's delight, but not in kind of like a too cheesy way. There's a little bit of cheese in it, but not too much. But I think two of the things that really help are a man called Dark Child, who's Rodney Jerkins, and Salaam Remy. Because between those two guys, I think they do 10 of the songs, actually. Yeah, 10 of the songs are between two producers. And that gives it a really consistent, unified sound in terms of the tone, the consistency, the concept. Now, the musical genres hop around all over the place, absolutely. But like you said, there's Parking Lot is like an MIA Junior song. Like, my wife walked in the other day and she's like, is that MIA? I was like, no, that's Nelly. She's like, what? But again, you see, look, this is my point. My wife walked in, didn't recognize the song whatsoever. No idea. And again, you know, Lucy's one of her favorite albums ever. So it's kind of like, this is exactly the conundrum that it just passed everyone by. It's crazy. Now, I know, like, you know, you're very much kind of purist when it comes to albums and say it doesn't, you know, you don't need to worry about singles and stuff. I totally get that. In this instance, it just needed one goddamn single. It just needed one single. Yeah, Big Hoops was not the one. As soon as it dropped, I was like, this is a pre-album single. This is not an actual proper single. Spirit Indestructible, I was like, Jesus, if you're already going for that as a single, then this is in trouble. Parking Lot was the one that you thought, okay, that could do something. And ironically, I mean, you're completely right. Bucket List is the one that probably could have done the most damage. I think it could have done really well, Bucket List. But it kind of got this kind of, quite a while afterwards, it got like a little, sort of like a budget video for it and stuff. But I think Bucket List could have hit the radio, you know?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, like properly.
Absolutely. I think if that was the first video, I think if that was the first thing and they made like a, if they planned around that song to make her comeback to come in there, and like do something interesting, like marketing wise, they could have did something with it. But I think it was just like they didn't know what to do with her, yeah. because that whole generation of kids went by her, and the only people that knew anything about her was Luce. I just feel like the 6 years hurt.
6 years.
I remember she was on BET, and I remember the reaction to people on Twitter, and they were like scratching their heads, like she's back, and like didn't even know what to make of it. A lot of Twitter, like. Twitter conversation about it when BET had it on there. They just didn't know what to make of it. All they said, she had a fat ass. That was all the only things I heard. But other than that, they were pretty much like, I don't know what to make of this right here.
Yeah.
And even a video with Big Hoops where she did all the Illuminati shit. I'm like, why are you doing the Illuminati? Like, are you trying to do like the Jay-Z plan with like On to the Next with all Illuminati imagery? I just didn't get why she was doing that on a throwback song.
Yeah. It didn't make sense, Big Hoops, the video. It was slightly distinctive when she's on stilts, and then the rest of it, I don't think it really made sense.
It was all Illuminati imagery. It just threw me off. I was like, what does that do with Big Hoops?
I didn't get that, if I'm honest.
Yeah?
I just think you're right when you say it's a throwback song, so why not do it as a throwback properly? You know, all you have to do is, like, you're right, she references so many songs. Kind of like, okay, why don't you take it back to, like, you know, do a late 90s video kind of thing. I know she, exactly. She kind of mentioned that it was kind of that feel-ish a little bit, but not really. You might as well have just done a house party as 90s.
Oh, yeah, or yeah, do like one of those like
Fisheye, you know, Hype Williams, Fisheye.
Yeah, or something like you do like a popular movie that was there and just redo it. You know what I'm saying? Like do a classic scene from the 90s.
Yeah.
And just do it Nelly Furtado style or something.
Okay, but even then, that song wouldn't have hit though. Big Hoops was just not, it was not a strong enough standalone radio single. It wasn't. If she'd led with Parking Lot or Bucket List, I think it would have done a lot more damage. But even outside all of that, and even Waiting for the Night, I think it was in certain markets that could have done well. But outside of those, I just don't think, I still think it needed one single. It just needed a big, big, cheesy, goddamn single. Just take the hit, do it,
Let me ask you a question.
Go.
Let me ask you a question. Do you think as good as you like this album? Do you think the sound was out of step with what was going on at the time?
Yeah, massively. Which is probably why it's matured so well. because okay, so it's funny because she was saying that once she started working with Dark Child. And then they were talking, and then she realized that he'd made loads of her favorite songs, that even the ones that she was referencing on Big Hoops and stuff like that, you know, which is a really bizarre thing to say, because did she really not know that he produced something like The Boy Is Mine by Brandy and Monica or this or that or whatever? It's kind of like, okay, did you really not know that? Because you're such a music head that did you really not know that? Is that just something you're saying? I never quite got that comment. But yeah, the interesting thing is, I think Dark Child comes across as someone, obviously he was deeply entrenched in R&B and hip hop and worked with Michael Jackson as well. He got massive at one point. He'd been out of the loop for a long time. So this is kind of a comeback for him a little bit as well. He really does a lot of different genres on this album. I was shocked. Well, yeah, a lot. Like, you're going for, you know, you got
especially the, Spirit. Especially the second half. Especially the second half, the bucket list.
Yeah. Yeah. No, on second half of the album, I think he only does two songs, actually. He does Waiting for the Night and Miracles.
Waiting for the Night Miracles. Oh, I'm sorry.
Yeah. So Waiting for the Night, I was pretty
sure. I'm talking about the sound yeah, overall.
The sound overall is, the second half is very varied. She always does this. She always does she always splits it into two. But he does a really good job. And Salaam Remy always does a great job. So although I have to say the one song I don't like on this is one that he produced, which is pretty bizarre, which is The Most Beautiful Thing. I can't stand that song. I don't know why. It just rubs me up the wrong way. you know when something just jars with you, melody.
You don't feel like, ah.
No.
You don't feel,
no.
Ooh, ah.
Especially as it comes after Bucket List, which is my favorite song. Okay, I tell you what. Let's do top threes on this one then. So what are your top three?
Bucket List is number one.
Yeah.
Spirit Indestructible is number two. It's a toss between three.
You can do five if you want. Cause I do like
this. Nah.
I'm going to do five.
Enemy.
Oh, damn it. You nicked my freaking one. Okay. I'm going to go Enemy, Bucket List, and... Right, I'm going to be really self-serving here and do five. So I'm going to do Parking Lot because I actually love that song. Spirit Indestructible, Big Hoops. Now, I would actually include something featuring Nas because Nas is fucking goat, but I'm going to include Big Hoops because I did a mix around that time, and basically I started off with Nas when he did that song with Don, which is from Life Is Good, which is from the same thing, and into it I brought in Big Hoops, the extended remix, and it's one of the best mixes I've ever done. When I dropped it, then people were just like phoning me like, oh my god, blah blah blah. So let me explain it. So okay, I bring in Big Hoops, Bigger the Better, Bigger the Better, right. So that comes in, and then as soon as I cut out Nas, then basically I cue up the acapella for Big Hoops, which I had as well. Get them synced, so I'm just using two decks here, and then I scratch out Big Hoops, the actual proper version, and just leave the acapella going. So it's going, I can go fast, I can go fast. So that's just dead except for the acapella. And then I bring in this Bhangra song by Punjabi MC called Morani, which was the massive giant song at that point. And I bring it in, and I just don't know. I just actually did it off the cuff. I didn't even plan it. And it's one of the best mixes I've ever done, by far. It's just incredible. So I still get compliments to this day, 5 years later, about that little secret. People are like, wow, blah, blah, blah. So I'll always have a lot of affection for that. And it's completely self-serving. That's why I chose Big Hoops. Even though something's better. Okay, so I tell you what, let's go through the album and pick out a few highlights, because I think if any album needs some fucking help, it's this. It needs us two to talk about this, basically. I'm not even like sucking my own dick. We just need to talk about it, because no one even ever talks about this. It's crazy. Absolutely. Do you know what? I was even looking for Nelly Furtado to talk about this album. Yeah. She barely mentions anything about this album. It's amazing. I just don't get it. All right, so Spirit Indestructible. I think it's a great way to start off the album, and it's a nice, varied production. The other thing I'd say is that it's very Timbaland-esque in a lot of ways, yeah. And I thought that was deliberate, because if you ignore that Me Plan exists, then this basically leads on from Loose. It's kind of got that. I think that's what she was going for. And it's very uplifting. Big Hoops, I think it's... I really like Big Hoops.
Yeah, it's a good song.
But I think it's a great album track, put it that way.
Yeah.
It's not a single. It just... And I can see why certain people didn't take to it, because her vocals are pretty strained on it, actually. I'd argue they're pretty strained.
The bigger, the better, the bigger, the bigger. What the scenario?
No, but the verse is... It's pretty strained, yeah. It's pretty strained. I don't know. It's funny, because when I dropped the a cappella of it, the a cappella on that mix, I was kind of like, okay, the a cappella's fine. There's nothing wrong with it. What's wrong with it? Who mastered this? It's really weird. High Life, I think it's a good song. Parking Lot, MIA, man. MIA all over it. It's amazing. And I know that she was kind of like a fan of some of the things MIA was doing and stuff. So I don't know if it's a direct rip. The other thing is the chorus on that. Nah, not the chorus, but the bridge. Nah, 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 nah.
Hey. Oh, yeah. Yeah,
someone made the comparison to I've Got My Mind Set on You. And then I was like, damn, that's actually quite... I got my mind set on you. And I was like, okay, that's actually quite accurate.
Mike Bell of Post Media News agreed, calling it the album's best moment, sound like a Gwen Stefani MIA mashup.
Yes. Yeah, Gwen Stefani's a good shout as well. Although, you're right. When you said
Eric Henderson of Slant Magazine said that it sounds like she's trying to win a bet that she could turn the hook from George Harrison's Got My Mind Set on You into a new Holla Back Girl.
Wow. Okay. Did you see the video for Parking Lot as well?
I just remember her being in a parking lot with some cars, and that's all I remember.
Yeah. I remember I didn't like the video at the time, and then I watched it again a few weeks ago with my son, actually, and I don't think he liked it. I think he kind of liked the minis in it, and then that was it, and then he was kind of like, no, I don't like it. But actually, he really liked the Waiting for the Night video.
Robert Copsey of Digital Spy wrote that the hypnotic, propelling melody of horns and synths will no doubt draw comparisons to MIA for its off-kilter vocals and bratty attitude, as she sheepishly remarks, bring your car to the parking lot and ride all night till you get a spot.
Yeah. I never even thought about the sexual connotations of Parking Lot. I think it's a great song, Parking Lot. Yeah, it's a shame that it didn't hit. I think you're right. A lot of this album is wrong timing as well. Something featuring Nas, I think it's a great song. It kind of very much sounds like Nas from that era of Life is Good. Again, we haven't had a Nas album since then. That's been 5 years. And Bucket List, I think, is the highest peak on this album, if I'm honest. It's just... there's something to that song. I think it just cuts away all the bullshit. And even if there's a couple of lyrics on it, they're a little bit clunky, actually. But something about the song just makes you just think, what am I doing with my life? it makes you just strip away everything. And just, it's amazing. It's an absolutely brilliant song. Incredible. I think it's one of the best songs she's ever done, to be honest.
Yeah, I agree. I do agree with that one.
And then the second half, Most Beautiful Thing, Don't Like It. Waiting for the Night, I think it's a good song. I can see why it didn't really hit as a single, but...
you know what I keep thinking about when I hear that song? I think about J-Lo's Waiting for the Night.
Exactly. It is a redux of that song, basically.
Whenever I hear that
and
song,
I don't know if it's supposed to
video,
be, because...
I think of that video.
Yeah, well, the thing is that I reckon a lot of this album is supposed to be kind of harking back to when Nelly was around that age, basically. I mean, you've even got that weird diary entry thing when she's talking on, is it Bucket List and Waiting for the Night? Because she even said, I think she said in interviews around the time that... I think she went to Portugal and she had a crush on a guy, and she was like, she must have been like 16, 17 or whatever, like that kind of age. So, and that's around the time J-Lo dropped Waiting for the Night. which was my song for the millennium, by the way.
Yeah?
Yeah. Not Will Smith. Please don't mention that Will Smith song.
You talk about the millennium?
Oh, my God. You ruined it. You ruined the whole podcast, man. Miracles, for me...
Not your head.
Yeah, Miracles was all right. Hang on. Which one's Miracles again? How does Miracles go? I'm getting confused.
I can't even tell you because now I'm thinking about Enemy right now. Miracles circles the Enemy kind of has like that same flow. Like that's the part of the album where it kind of has like that Waiting for the Night kind of the Most Beautiful Thing kind of sets everything up and it kind of goes into that mid tempo, like drone, hypnotic until Believers come out.
Yeah, yeah. It definitely does. It's very kind of makes you think back, you know.
Reflective.
Yeah, reflective. Yeah, yeah. That's
nostalgic. Very reflective. Yeah. Enemy has the catchiest hook.
Yeah.
And I think the other two kind of like they have different feels, but unless you hear them, it's weird. It's not a bad thing, but it like after the Beautiful Thing, it gets you into a mode until Believers come back out. It's kind of like after all the hectic stuff of the beginning part of the album, it's like this is more the laid back until Believers come out.
Yeah, I could have done without Most Beautiful Thing, but. Like, Bucket List into Waiting for the Night, I think, would have made more sense.
Okay.
Circles is actually low-key a really good song. And we'll talk for, like, a little bit about The Ride at the end of this podcast. I can see Circles being kind of like a precursor to The Ride. Already in a lot of ways, I can tell musically that's the kind of direction. Not direct direction, but if you talk about anything from this album that was looking forward to The Ride, I think it's Circles, definitely. Enemy, I think it's just a classic. I just love that song so much. That could have just been so big. You're so right, actually. If this had come like 1 or 2 years after Loose, the Enemy is exactly the kind of song. It had been produced by Salaam Remy, who was so hot then. I always imagine Amy Winehouse being able to sing something like this song, actually, Enemy. It feels like she's channeling something about Amy Winehouse. I don't know why, I just get that feeling. And then Believers is a funny one. I can tell why people didn't like it. It's kind of very 80s U2.
Rocky, yeah.
Yeah. But I loved it. I loved it.
I like the song too, yeah.
Yeah, and you know, it gets some politics in there as well, because it's about the Arab Spring. I don't know. I just, this album, the whole album, I think is great, save for one song for me. And even that song, I don't hate it. I just don't like it. It's just... Okay, so it's. I think it's a real shame it didn't hit, but I think I can see multiple reasons why it didn't hit. Again, this is why I just say sometimes, you know what, just take the fucking L and make one cheesy goddamn single that you know will. Just do it, whatever it takes, by hook or by crook, because this is that album, by hook or by crook. If it had one single to really kick off momentum, then the others would have done all right. Like Big Hoops as a third or fourth single would have been fine. Waiting for the Night as a third or fourth single would have been fine. Bucket List as a second single could have been huge. Or Parking Lot as a second single.
You just needed that opening?
You just need that in, right? You need your foot in the door sometimes, especially as you've said, after 6 years, she needed to get something back in there. She needed something to get her back into public consciousness, put it that way. Because, you know, she dropped off the face of the earth for most people. I don't know. It's just a shame. I just think more and more I look back on this album and think it's just such a shame that it didn't have one big single, because I think it would have been really good. I think, okay, should we do a kind of ranking of her five albums?
You can say four for now.
All right, because Me Plan will be fifth anyway, so all right.
Yeah, but. Yeah. So that's already going to be on the bottom, so we can just get to four.
All right. So how would you do it? You do it.
You want me to do it? Okay, mine's very easy. So you got Folklore, Will and Nelly, Spirit Indestructible, and Loose.
Okay. Now, what would you say the differential between those four albums is? Like, I mean, would you say that...
I'm going to do two grades. I'm going to do my personal, and I'm going to do... The second number is going to be, like, my hard-nosed critical thing. Okay, so Folklore for me is a 10, and if I'm being critical, then I would say it's a 7.5. Then I would say Will and Nelly for me personally is a 9, And then I would say critically, it's a 9. I would say Spirit Indestructible, personally, is a 7. And I would say critically, it's a 7. And then I would say for me, Loose is a 5, personally. And then critically, I would say a 7.
Okay. I think you changed your scores for Loose within the last 25.
No, I said 7. I said 7 for...
No, but
five,
personally,
four.
Even... Did you say 5?
Personally, it's 5. Personally, it's 5, yes.
Okay.
And I gave it 7. I said if I put my critical hat on, I said 7. Or the listeners could tell me I'm a liar later on, I guess.
Yeah, this will be a good test.
But I'm pretty sure it's 5. I don't think I gave it higher than a 5 on personal, but go ahead.
If only there's some way we could find out in the future. All right. The four albums for me, I'm going to go... Oh, man, do you know what? I haven't actually thought this through properly. I'd probably go number one spot... I'd probably go Wo Nelly, actually.
Mm-hmm.
Number one. Loose, number two. Spirit Indestructible, number three.
Mm-hmm.
And Folklore, number four. But again... That could be interchangeable. And I think for me, the differential between them is probably a bit more narrow than you. So
yeah.
I don't know. Like my favorite is Loose for sure. For it, if you talk about personal memories, followed by Wo Nelly. But this album is really creeping up there, man. Like, I love it. I absolutely love this album. Folklore is the one I've got the least attachment to for sure. But if you talk about critically, I think it's one of her best albums, definitely. But I don't know, like, she's got four great albums. I just like all of them. I know they're not all-time classics, like, all four of them are all-time. I get that. But, like I said, she's someone that I've just always had a lot of affection for from day one. She just spoke to me immediately. And, yeah, I'm just always going to love her. I mean, all right, I'll tell you what. Let's wrap all that up and then talk about The Ride just for a couple of minutes. So, have you listened to any of the songs from it? There's three songs that have released thus far.
I haven't really given it. Listen, I was going to do the thing where I was just going to... Just when it comes out, I'm just gonna listen to it. But
okay.
I may or may not go back through. I mean, I heard like a part of a song, but then I just flicked it off, and I was like, I'll just wait. We'll see what happens. Maybe I'll change my mind after I'm done listening to it, after we're done doing the podcast.
Yeah, so I've listened to all three of the singles actually.
Uh-huh.
Not singles, but you know, the three songs that have been released thus far, and on repeat as well. Like, it's actually quite funny. Yesterday I was putting up some curtains in the living room, so it's like a good couple of hours job, and I ended up just leaving Pipe Dreams on repeat one, so literally just one song for 2 hours, and it passed the test basically. So she's released Cold Hard Truth, which is the first song on the album. It's this great kind of intro song. Then I think track number two is Flatline. Flatline is kind of sounds like it's getting more into single territory. I don't think it's a very good single. I think it's a perfectly decent album track. I don't think it's going to hit as a single. I hope that's not the single, put it that way. it won't do anything at all. Pipe Dreams is a lovely song. I think that's been out since quite a while, actually, like 4 or 5 months at least. That's a beautiful song. Beautiful. It's kind of okay. So basically, on Spirit Indestructible, she did the one song I don't like is the most beautiful thing or whatever it's called. Pipe Dreams is like that, but a much, much better version. Much better. So it's basically she's hooked up with this guy John Congleton, the producer, and he's basically done a lot of work with a lot of indie bands, very well respected indie bands, and much more underground artists. So I think he's even said, "Look, Nelly Furtado is probably the most high profile commercial artist that I've ever worked with," and so it's going to be a very, very fascinating album to see. I think regardless of anything, I don't think it's going to do anything commercially much, and I think she probably knows that. I think this is a release for her, like a metaphorical release for her. She said that, you know, she's struggled a lot over the last few years. I think she split from her manager, which was a big deal because he was her manager for like almost 18 years or something crazy. And then the record label situation has changed as well. So I think this will probably just be through Nelstar, I would have thought. Yeah, I think it's exclusively through her own label, actually. It's not going to have any of that. It's not going to have any of that Loose sound. I don't know. I just think it's going to be a good album, basically. I think it's going to be a good album. It will have good lyrics on it. It will have really interesting production by John Congleton and a couple of others. And I reckon it's going to hit the spot for Nelly Furtado fans. Outside of that, I don't really see much happening, if I'm honest. But that's basing it on the three songs that have been released. There might be something on there that hits the mark, but who knows?
Do you think it might
I'm really
like
looking
a,
forward
like
to
a,
it.
Like a Grammy kind of album?
It could be, potentially. It could be one of these where, you know, you have a respected producer, you have someone who's coming back after a long time. If it hits the right mark, you just don't know. I think she's going more for critical respect. Put it this way, I'm looking at...
That's what I'll make
my like. Yeah, I'm making my prediction that this will get like a 7.8 on Pitchfork or something like that, basically. I think it will get a good score on there. And it let's just see how it goes, basically. Let's see. But I think it will be a strong album.
So you have hope by what you listen to?
I absolutely have hope. I think it's going to be a good album, for sure. Mm-hmm. I don't think commercially it's going to do anything, but... I mean, who really cares? I think at this point
in her life.
Yeah, I mean, she's been in the game. She released Whoa Nelly 17 years ago, almost. I mean, that's like a whole person who can vote practically. You know, you're closing in on that. So I don't think she really cares anymore. She's not exactly struggling for money. She's putting this through her own record label. Oh, go on then.
I will say I like how the cover has like the picture of her in the middle, but it's a green. It's like her inside of like a green cover, and then AIM had MIA's picture.
Yeah,
surrounded by orange.
Isn't it completely? Yeah, isn't that basically. I was gonna say. Do you know what? I was kind of flip flopping on if I'd say it or not, but very very AIM, like, you know, definitely. Although I'm not actually sure if Pipe Dreams came out before AIM and had that artwork already, but I'm not sure. I haven't fact checked that. So yeah, I think it's going to be a strong album. But I think it'll be an album. I don't think there's going to be any big singles from it. I don't think so. I mean, let's see, but whatever. Okay, cool. Well, we've gone past the mark, and yeah, have you got any kind of final thoughts on Nelly, or have we put it out all on the field?
I think we pretty much covered everything. Yeah. I mean, after we did the album rankings, I think people who are inclined to give her a shot pretty much knows where we stand on certain things.
Yeah. And I just want to say thank you to Nelly, because I fucking love you. She's just brilliant. You're one of my favorite artists. No, but honestly, I think sometimes, you know, obviously we do this podcast and it's really fascinating for both of us, because we'll kind of push each other to listen to certain things outside our comfort zone. But I think we're both Nelly fans. But this listening to her over the last month, it's just brought home. She really is one of my favourite singers this century. I just love her. I get her. And I would tell my kids, yeah, you know what? You probably haven't heard much of her, but you should listen to her. You'd like. I can't really say anything more than that. Like, I've got a very exclusive list that I would pass down to my children. So she made the cut. All right, cool. I don't know if we're going to do one on the ride. I'd actually quite like to, but let's see if we could. That would be
see,
dope.
Maybe, happens, yeah.
Yeah. Maybe like a short one, half an hour one or something.
Yeah.
Okay. Well, my name is Jesal and...
Rochard.
So we say peace.
Peace.